Welcome back. In the last lecture we presented preliminary concepts of predicate logic, where we introduce syntax of predicate logic. So in this class I will be in continuation with the last class, we will be talking about some of the basic building blocks of predicate logic. The basic building blocks of predicate logic is that predicates, first thing to start with, and you have objects and you have terms, etc., and all. So we'll define all these things one by one in greater detail with some examples. So this class is dedicated to so syntax of predicate logic. So what we will be doing is, when do you say that a given well-formed formula is a given formula is considered to be a formula, well-formed formula, or when do we say that a particular formula is considered to be a kind of formula in predicate logic, etc., and all. So to start with, these are some of the building blocks of predicate logic. To start with, we need to have some kind of objects. They are the things which exist in the world. It can be cats, dogs, or anything. We can give these names such as umbrella, person, John, earth, etc., and all. All these things are referring to some kind of objects. And we have also relations and properties, relations between these objects, such as the relationship between Ravi and Sita is wife, siblings, etc., and all. So we need to have relations, and we need to have functions, such as a type of relation that maps an input to some kind of value. These are considered to be functions. To start with, usually we represent predicates with capital letters. Actually, what we need to know, note before this is that in the context of prepositional logic, we represented all the sentences as some kind of prepositional variable. So that is, so for example, if I represent X, that means it stands for maybe like it is raining, etc. So the compound sentences are formed by combining these atomic sentences, which are represented by some kind of prepositional variables. So our logical connectives and R implies negation, etc., will take care of combining these simple sentences into a compound kind of sentences. So in the predicate logic, the story is a little bit different. So we need to go into the deep structure of our sentences. So what is essential for us is the predicate and the relations, the objects, etc. All these things are very important for us. So all these things are important, especially when you are trying to interpret a given sentence. So sentences in predicate logic are not so simple like the ones which you have already seen in the case of prepositional logic. So if you are asked to say, if you are asked to find out the truth value of it is raining and it is not raining, it's so simple. Whatever value that it is raining and not raining takes, it is P and not P. Obviously, the truth value of that particular kind of sentence is false, because it is a contradiction. But it is not so simple in the case of predicate logic. Predicate logic, we need to go into the details, deep structure of these particular kinds of sentences, where we need to interpret especially predicates, relations, objects, etc. So the semantics of predicate logic, we will talk about it in the next class, but we will focus our attention on our basic building blocks to start with predicates. A predicate letter will usually be associated with a list of at least one variable. That is, suppose if you have AX, then it is considered to be a unary predicate. And if you have, let us say, if you represent X and Y are considered to be variables, and then A is considered to be a predicate. So that is considered to be a binary predicate. A can be some kind of relation, etc. Suppose if you want to say in between X, Y, Z, etc., or in between X and Y, you need to have a tertiary kind of predicates B, X, Y, Z. So usually a predicate is used to represent a property of its variable or a relationship between its variables. When you have a unary predicate, it is talking about the property of a particular human being. For example, if you say Socrates is mortal, then mortality is a property which is attributed to the variable, that is Socrates. Here in this case it is specific, so you represent it as S and X. So for example, if you want to represent all men are mortal, then mortality is attributed to all human beings, that is H, X, etc. So a predicate is used to represent a kind of property of its variable or a kind of relationship between its variables. In the case of father X, Y, in a particular kind of order, X is considered to be father of Y. Suppose if you represent like this, in the first case it is like this. So now in this one, X is a variable, this is considered to be a variable, and some kind of property is attributed to this one. This H is considered to be a predicate, and then this is considered to be a quantifier. So this is the structure of this particular kind of thing. So a predicate can also be represented in this particular kind of way. So now in the second case, it is talking about the relationship between X and Y. So it can be less than or greater than Y if you are talking about natural numbers. Suppose if you are talking about human beings, you can say that let us say if I write like this, there is a particular kind of order which is followed here. So this means X is a wife of Y, or if you write like this, X is father of Y. So this is different from wife, Y and X. If you change the order here, order of your variables, terms, that is what you call it as terms representing some kind of variables. If you replace this one like this, these two are not the same. So this is a kind of a binary kind of predicate, and then if you want to represent more than two, then you represent it in this way, X, Y, Z. For example, someone is sitting in between X, Y and Z, and in betweenness for example requires, let us say, more than three variables in all. So like this you can go on and on, you can talk about n-ary kind of predicates and all. So as usual, we have the connectives and R implies, double implies, negation, etc. These are the same as in the case of prepositional logic, and they mean exactly the same, that is N stands for R, N stands for this upside down V stands for AND, and V stands for OR, and implies arrow stands for implies, and if and only if stands for this thing, bidirectional kind of connective, and negation is as it is. So we have unary, binary and tertiary kind of predicates, and different textbooks it is represented in a different way. So sometimes you can write like this, A, X, Y and Z, or in some textbooks it is written in this way. So they are more or less the same, or in the same way, for example L, X, Y, some kind of property L, let us say L, X loves Y and all. So in some textbooks it is written as love is considered to be the predicate which comes first. We give a lot of emphasis to the predicates, and these are the objects. So they represent some kind of individual variables, and when you represent replace this X and Y with some individual variables, then for example it takes a value A and B. A and B are referring to some specific kind of individuals like John, Ravi, Sita, etc. So these are the basic building blocks. To start with, after the predicates, predicate consists of terms and all, terms in particular. And what do we mean by a term in the predicate logic? So the definition is like this. So we will be following some kind of definitions. Some of the definitions sound technical, but I'll try to explain or try to make it as simpler as possible. So now to start with, what do we mean by a term? So every variable is considered to be a term. So any variable that you take into consideration, so that is going to be a term. So suppose if you represent this thing, so this is considered to be a term, or an individual constant like this can also be treated as a term. Okay. So every constant symbol is also considered to be a term, like A, B, C's, etc. So that is the thing. So these are the preliminary things one need to note. Either if you write individual variables like X, X stands for anything, like Sita, Gita, Ram, etc. and all, an individual constant A that is also considered to be a term. Usually a predicate consists of terms. So if f is a kind of n-ary function symbol, that means n is equal to 0 to 1 to n, and then t1 to tn are the terms, then f t1 to tn is also considered to be a term. So it is like n-ary function means, for example, if suppose if you are representing only two variables, it's a binary function and all, it's a relationship between x and y. So these are considered to be terms and all. So now we have t1, t2, tn are terms. So these represents either individual variables x, xyz, etc. and all. This xyz can be replaced later, or it can be individual constants like a, b, c, etc. and all. They are specifically referring to individual objects like dust, chalk piece, etc. So now these are considered to be terms and all, and if f is n-ary function, that means if it is a binary function, if it is binary function, then you have two variables x and y like this. 3 means x, y, z, etc. fn means x2, you can take in this way, x1 to xn. If it is n-ary function, then these are also, these are already considered to be terms, then f of t1 to tn is also considered to be a term. So that is what it says. So a term has to be defined at least in these three ways. Anything which is not defined in this kind of thing is not considered to be a term. So out of this terms, there are certain specific kind of terms which are considered to be ground terms. So what are these ground terms? These are the terms with no variables. So these are considered to be ground kind of terms. So in the sense that you have already exhaustively replaced these individual variables with these variables with some kind of individual objects, like x, y, z are replaced by some constants like a, b, c. They are referring to some specific individual objects, and in that case these are considered to be variable free terms, or they can also be considered as ground terms. So in this case, for example, f of t1, t2, etc., tn, so now you replace these terms with some kind of individual variable, individual constants like a, b, c, etc. So then this is considered to be these terms are considered to be the terms which exist in that particular kind of n-ary function f are considered to be ground terms. So sometimes you will have only one variable, sometimes you can have more than one variable with one free variable, etc. So now to make it more explicit, a term is said to be closed or a ground term if it contains no free variables. For example, if t1 and t2 are considered to be term and x is considered to be a variable, we can use different kind of notation. So a term t1 is such that t1 is like this, t2 is replaced, x is replaced by t2. So that means t1 t2 oblique x, it denotes a term resulting from the replacement of every occurrence of x in t1 by t2. So there's some examples which we take into consideration and we will try to make it clear. So now let us say this is the notation that we are following now, t2 and x. So these are the terms and all, t1, t2, and x is considered to be a variable. So now, so in this term t1, so t1 is resulted especially when wherever you have x that is replaced by another term t2. So then that is what is resulting by this particular kind of formula. So this results in, by replacement of every occurrence of x in this term t1 with T2. Some examples which you can take into consideration, for example, if you have this particular kind of thing 3 into 2 plus y 2 and x, 3x plus y and 2x, that means it stands for this thing that wherever you have x you have replaced it with 2. This is some of the notation that we can use in all. So now this this is considered to be a formula in that you have a term x stands for individual variable, so now this x is replaced by 2. So now this will become where plus y, let us for a time being you have a formula like this 3x square plus y. So now you replaced x with 2, so now this will become 2 square plus y, so now this will become 12 plus y. So this means wherever you have x you replace it with 2, that is what it says. So what is a 2? It is a kind of individual constant which you are replacing this y with x with 2, so then the formula will become 12 plus y. In the same way in this formula 3x square plus y you replace x with 2y plus 1, so then this formula will become like this. So wherever x is there you replace it with 2y plus 1 whole to the power of 2 plus y, so whatever formula which results in is considered to be the resultant term. So a term is said to be closed if it contains no free variables. So this is, this tells us how to replace the individual variables with some kind of constants. So now we spoke about what we mean by terms and when individual some variables can be replaced with some kind of constants in a term, all these things which we spoke about it in some kind of detailed manner. So now let us talk about what we mean by a formula in predicate logic. So predicate logic is also considered to be term logics, just like you know in the case of Aristotelian logic, in the case of classical Aristotelian logic it also talks about terms, but it fails to explain those arguments in which it consists of complex terms or simple singular terms and complex terms and the terms which include some kind of relations and all. So predicate logic, the Aristotelian logics in a way fall short of explaining these complex terms and singular terms in a satisfactory manner. So in a sense predicate logic is also considered to be kind of term logics or predicate logic, it may be even called as first order logic. So we will talk about what we mean by first order logic little bit later. So now let us consider what we mean by saying that a given string of symbols are considered to be a formula. So these are also considered to be assertions in the predicate logic, the definition goes like this. So we need to have some particular kind of language, that is the language of predicate logic, which consists of all the individual variables, constants, terms, predicates, etc., and the functions, etc. The set of open formulas over L is given inductively by the following rules. So let us consider if R is a relation symbol of arity n, that means a unary predicate, binary predicate, etc., and T1 to Tn are considered to be terms, then R of T1 to Tn is also considered to be a formula. So it is like P T1 T2 Tn is considered to be a formula, it is also considered to be atomic formula in the predicate logic. So you have terms and you have a relation, that is what you know. For example if you can represent R T1 to Tn as simply W X Y N, where W stands for wife and X stands for Ravi and Y stands for Sita, for example Ravi is Sita is wife of Ravi, so W X Y in that particular kind of order. So we have T1 T2 Tn here. So anything if R is a relation symbol which relates some kind of objects in your language, and then R T1 T2 Tn is also considered to be a formula. So as usual in the case of propositional logic if alpha and beta are two formulas, alpha n plus beta alpha and beta alpha r beta, all these things are also considered to be terms. And the third thing is that if alpha is considered to be a formula and x is considered to be a variable, then the only thing which is different in the case of predicate logic are these things. So there exists some x alpha is also considered to be a formula. These are the two things, two quantifiers that we will be using in the predicate logic. It is in that sense it is an extension of prepositional logic. Anything which you extend it with two more, extend the prepositional logic with two more quantifiers, like for all x there exists some x, and it will become predicate logic. So then there exists some x alpha, or for all x alpha is also considered to be a formula. These are the additional things which you find it in the predicate logic. And alpha is usually considered to be within the scope of your quantifier. For example, if you have so this essentially says that when you say that a given kind of string of letters that I am going to write on the board is considered to be a formula. So the first thing is that T1, T2 individual terms are also obviously considered to be formulas and all, and anything which you write like this Tn, if T1, T2, Tn are formulas, anything which you write it like this FT1, T2 is also considered to be a term which obviously is considered to be formula. Then this usually we replace it with R, sometimes you can even write it as P. So now the second thing is that as usual in the case of prepositional logic, if alpha and beta are formulas, and all these things are also considered to be formulas, and negation of alpha etc. This is the second thing. And the third thing is that for all x, so the other thing is that there are two quantifiers which you can use, there exists some x alpha. So this is considered to be quantifier, it talks about for all x alpha is, alpha holds for all the property, all the objects x. So now alpha holds for some x, so here this x stands for a variable, individual variable, and alpha is within the scope of this particular kind of quantifier. So that is what it says. So here alpha is said to be within the scope of the quantifier. The quantifier is in the case the first one it is for all alpha, and the second case it is there exists some kind of alpha, there exists some x alpha. So anything which is defined in the following three ways is considered to be a formula, but anything which is defined not in this particular kind of sense is considered to be not a formula. So this is just like in the case of prepositional logic we talked about some kind of formation rule. Any string of formula cannot be considered as a well formed formula. So like this we have in addition to these terms etc. which are new here, and we have two quantifiers for all x and there exists some x. So now we need to talk about what we mean, what exactly these quantifiers are all about. So some examples of formulas are like this. So x is greater than y because x greater than is a property which is relating x and y. So it can be written as Rxy simply, and it shows that greater than is a sign which is represented by a relation R, or property. Or you can say for all there exists some x for all y, x is less than y. Or you can simply write x has a particular kind of property, that is the prime number. So in that sense 17 is considered to be a prime number, so prime 17. You can write sibling can be sister, brother, anything, x and y, x is a brother of y, y is a sister of x etc. So if you want to represent anything between p1 p2 p3, that is b p1 p2 p3. So one can write it in the linear order, or sometimes you can even write in this particular kind of thing. Suppose in some textbooks it is written like this PXYZ, and if I want to avoid this particular kind of notation I can write in this way also PXYZ, it means the same thing. You know, some textbooks they maintain this particular kind of notation, in some other textbooks you will find the other notation. So to continue with what we have discussed so far, the terms are either considered to be variables, constants and functions which are functions which apply to terms, that is f t1 t2 tn is considered to be a term, just a summary of what we have discussed so far. And variables are also considered, variables are usually represented by small letters x, y, z, usually these are replaced by terms t1, t2, a, b, c, etc. and all constants, representing some kind of arbitrary objects from the universe, like some people, some man, or some bright students of IITK, like that. So it is referring to arbitrary objects within some kind of universe. So you have to note that in predicate logic, whatever we are trying to talk about makes sense only when it refers to some kind of domain or universe of discourse. It doesn't make any sense if you don't have some kind of universe of discourse. So for example, something which holds for natural numbers may not hold for real numbers, etc., or integers, etc. So we need to specifically talk about the domain that you are trying to talk about in the beginning of analyzing these sentences in predicate logic. So constants are underlined letters such as a, b, c's, etc., representing particular objects from the universe. If you want to refer to this particular kind of duster, it is this thing, or this particular kind of chalk piece, etc. They are all referred by constants. This is what we have discussed so far. And functions are usually represented as again small letters, except the predicates. You will see all the things which you will find it in your vocabulary will have small letters. F x y means f is a function which is applied to variables x and y. So now sometimes there might be a lot of confusion between function and predicate, the usage of function and a predicate. So here is the distinction between a function and a predicate. So the usually the value of a function is an object, while the value of a predicate is considered to be a truth value. So let us consider some examples so that this distinction will become clear. So this is one of the important distinction, that is the value of a function is considered to be an object, whereas the value of a predicate is considered to be a truth value. That means for example, if you say Ravi is husband of Sita, for example. So this is usually represented as this thing. So this is the predicate. So being husband is considered to be a predicate. And then let us say you write it in this particular kind of thing. This says that X is a husband of Y, where X is considered to be Ravi. We replace it with individual terms, then it will become this thing, Sita. Ravi is a wife, husband of Sita. So this is in a particular kind of order. Suppose if X stands for Ravi and Y stands for Sita, and indeed these are considered to be the states of affairs, then obviously it takes a value either T or F. So that is what the predicate does and all. The value of a predicate is always considered to be some kind of truth value, either it has to be 0 or it has to be 1. For example, if you say Manmohan Singh is let us say Prime Minister of India. So suppose if you say that particular kind of thing, Prime Minister is considered to be the predicate and X is considered to be the Prime Minister of India. X is referring to Manmohan Singh and Y is referring to India, then this is the property, that is being the Prime Minister is considered to be the property. Suppose if you say some other name and then replace it with this one, it takes the value f. So that means the predicate, the value of a predicate is will take the value f. So the value of a predicate always takes some kind of truth value, either it's true or false. Suppose if you want to represent the father of X, it makes sense to use a particular kind of function fx, father of the nation, etc. It refers to some kind of object, such as Mahatma Gandhi, etc., a Prime Minister of India, that is referring to Manmohan Singh, some kind of object. They can refer to f of x, so that is referring to some kind of object, it is mapping to some kind of object. On the other hand, if you want to say that x is a father, then now it should take some kind of truth value. So now you use px, that is, let's see if you want to represent this thing, father of Jawaharlal Nehru, f of Jawaharlal Nehru, is referring to some kind of object, I mean another object with which exists within your domain, that is considered to be Motilal Nehru. We know the facts, so that's why. Now predicate Motilal, for example, that is P stands for is a father of Motilal, that can take only value either true or false. If it refers to states of affairs that indeed Motilal Nehru is considered to be father of Jawaharlal Nehru, of course the statement is true which occurs in the predicate logic is true, otherwise it is going to be false. So this is the final distinction between the function and predicate. We often make mistakes in using these things, isn't these things in our language, that is function versus predicate is like this. So the minute distinction that you need to note here is that the value of a function is always considered to be an object, it maps to some kind of object, whereas in the case of a predicate, the value of a predicate is always going to be some kind of truth value, either it has to be true or false. So that is f of Jawaharlal Nehru is referring to some kind of object, that is Motilal Nehru, whereas p, being a father of Motilal, whether or not he is a father of, indeed if he is a father then the statement is going to be true, otherwise it is going to be false, the value of that one is either true or false. That is the minute distinction between the function and predicate. So far we discussed about some of the basic building blocks of predicate logic. To start with, we started with the terms and then predicates, and now one of the important things that you need to discuss is the quantifiers, I mean or the quantifiers. So there are two quantifiers that you will see in the predicate logic. One is, if you want to quantify over the entire universe of discourse, you use universal quantifier for all x, or if you are trying to refer to some kind of individuals within your universe of discourse, you refer to existential quantifier. So for all x is usually read as, for that is the name for this, for all x which is in the red. So it claims that a formula that follows is true for all kinds of values x. For example, if you want to say all human beings are mortal, mortality is attributed to not a single human being, but it is referring to the whole group of individuals that exist in the given domain. The domain here is this, the domain of universe of discourse which consists of all human beings. Of course if you refer to animals, then that thing is going to be, maybe that might also be true, but if you are referring to some other kinds of object domain, maybe it might be false. So there exists some x is usually read as, there exists an x. It claims that a formula that follows anything after this quantifier is going to be true for at least one value of x. So for example, if you say that all some IITK students are intelligent, then it refers to only if some IITK students are intelligent, means at least one is intelligent, that itself shows that some are considered to be intelligent. So that satisfies this particular kind of sentence. If you have more it is good enough, but definitely you want to make a distinction between all IITK students are intelligent and some students are considered to be intelligent. So that is the difference between existential quantifier and the universal quantifier. So there is some kind of important, we need to maintain this particular kind of distinction, and there are some efforts to say that whether for all x ax is true implies that there exists some x ax or not. So these are the kind of inferences that are troublesome kind of inferences and all. So usually our temptation is this, that for example if you say for all x ax, and from this can we infer there exists some x fx, or the other way around, if you have something like there exists some x fx, from this can we generalize it and say that it is for all x fx. Whether these can be considered to be rules of inference and all, these are things which we will talk about later, but there are a lot of issues which are surrounding these particular kinds of inferences. Even Aristotle was also talking about this particular kind of inferences. Suppose if you infer something like for all unicorns, all unicorns are intelligent, and this stands for some unicorns are intelligent. From that you obtain this particular kind of thing. Since intelligence is attributed to all human beings, maybe some are also considered to be intelligent. But once you infer this particular kind of thing, there exists some X. Here the problem here is that you are importing existence into the conclusion, which is not there in the premises. In the premises, there is no commitment for the existence of the unicorns here, but you can still use in an abstract terms all unicorns are intelligent etc. and all in the premises, but still you not have to have unicorns to exist in the world. But here once you say that there exists some X fx, then there is some kind of we imported existence which is not there in the premises to the conclusion, and that kind of inference is considered to be a kind of fallacy, which Aristotle talks about it as existential. And in the modern terms, in the Boolean terms, it is considered to be an existential fallacy. So how they resolve this existential fallacy and all, we will talk about later. But so this is the minute distinction between for all X and there exists some X. And let us consider some examples so that we will understand this concept in a better way. So for all X, X into 0 is 0, that means any term multiplied by 0 is going to be 0. It happens for any number that you are going to take into consideration, whether it is a real number or complex number or any number that you take into consideration. So now for this, whether or not this statement is true etc. and not, we require a domain. Either you need to talk about natural numbers or real numbers or integers, rational numbers etc. and all. Within the domain you take X as some kind of number. If you are talking about natural number, you take 1, 2, 3 etc. and all. Then for all X, any X you take into consideration, if this property X into 0 is 0 holds for all the letters that you have exhaustively listed out, in that case it happens, it holds for all the numbers, all the members of X, X times 0 equals to 0. So the, in that case it is going to be true. We will talk about truth and falsity a little bit later, but right now we are trying to talk, we are focusing our attention on how we are using the quantifiers. So we did not enter into the details of what we mean by these quantifiers. Semantics will take care of what exactly we use these quantifiers and all, how we use these quantifiers etc. We will talk about it when we discuss about the quantifiers. Second sentence, for all X there exists some Y, X multiplied by Y is equivalent to 1. So now your domain is real numbers here, and there are two real numbers X and Y, and if you multiply these two real numbers X and Y, that's it so happened that the multiplication leads to 1, and this holds for all X, at least for all X means you take 1, 2, 3 etc. and all, for all these elements and all there exists at least some Y, that Y is also another real number. For all these things there is some Y and all, for that if you multiply some of the things which are there here with some of the element here, then you will generate a number 1. Whether it is true or not we will talk about a little bit later, but this is what it conveys, the information that it conveys is this thing, for all X there exists some Y, if any number X is multiplied by Y, whatever number randomly you take into consideration, and then you choose another Y from another Y which happens to be another real number, you multiply it and its multiplication leads to 1. So some examples of quantifiers. So now one example could be like this. We need to talk about the domain of discourse. Usually in the case of natural in the case of numbers you have to define it properly. It can be real numbers, it can be rational numbers, complex numbers etc. So now let us consider natural numbers as your universe of discourse. So let pi xy denotes a kind of relation all between X and Y, so that is X is less than Y. So now we have a function X which relates X and Y, where X is considered to be domain and Y is a range which is represented in terms of order pair XY, that is considered to be a binary function which talks about this thing X plus Y, and ABCs are considered to be constants naming some kind of numbers. Suppose if you are referring individual number and all, that is 0 stands for A, maybe 1 stands for B, 2 stands for C, etc. And all like that, you go on and on. If you exhaust these constants and all, you can use A1, A2, A3, etc. So now in that context, given the universe of discourse natural numbers, and then we have a relation x less than y, and you have a function that is x plus y, etc. So here x is less than y, less than is considered to be a predicate. That is a property which is on these two objects. So these two objects are related by a predicate being less than. So now there exists some x, phi, x, y. It is considered to be an unary predicate, which says that, which says of y that there is at least one natural number less than it, where y is not equivalent to 0. So you take any numbers, for example 1, 2, 3, 2, n and all, you take any number other than 0, let us say take 1, that is obviously less than any other element, that is 2, etc. Or in the same way 2 is less than 3, 3 is less than 4, etc. So now in the second context, for all x there exists y, phi of x, y, starting that for any natural number x there is a natural number y which is greater than x. It is in the context of the first one, x is less than y. The same thing is represented in terms of this thing. Suppose if you want to represent that for any natural number that you take into consideration, there is always a natural number y which is greater than x. So that is represented by this thing. For all x at least there is some y such that phi here stands for less than y, and all phi stands for a property being less than something, x is less than y. For all x there exists some y, x is less than y is represented by phi x y. So this is the way we represent this thing. In this one, for all x there exists some y are considered to be quantifier, and phi stands for a predicate and xy stands for individual variables when it refers to individual constants like the numbers like 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. and all, then it takes some kind of value. So far we discussed about terms, predicates, etc. and the quantifiers. Then given any formula in particular, we can talk about to what extent this quantifier operates. So that is considered to be the scope of the quantifier. So depending upon the scope of the quantifier, we can say that the variables exist in your formula are considered to be either free or bounded. This is what we mean by bondage and freedom. For example, if you have for all x phi is a sub formula of another formula phi is a big formula like x or y or z, etc. and all. In that you have taken into consideration the part of it and all, that is some considered to be a sub formula of phi, then phi is called as the scope of a particular occurrence of a quantifier for all x in phi. So that is considered to be the scope of it. The same applies to the occurrences of when you are talking about there exists some x. So you have a formula, in that formula only the quantifier operates over some kind of sub formulas, not over entire formula and all, but it operates over some kind of sub formula. So its scope is still that extent only. So beyond that there is no the other variables that exist there are going to be free variables. So we'll talk about the scope of the quantifier with some examples, and we'll talk about what is the significance of this one. So some examples which we can talk about. So what we mean by, first of all, what we mean by free and bound variables: an occurrence of an individual variables means x, y, z, etc. and all, they are considered to be bound within the scope of a quantifier if and only if it is within the quantificational within the scope of a quantificational expression that contains the individual occurrences of that kind of individual variables. An occurrence of a variable is considered to be free if and only if it is not considered to be bound. Now let us consider one example so that we'll understand what we mean by scope of a given quantifier. So the example that is there here is like this: for all x fx and cy, some terms which are represented in this way. So there is one bracket here implies. So I'm just listing out one formula, and then we are trying to see what is the scope of the quantifiers. The quantifiers here are for all x and there exists some y, zy. There exists some y, zy, and hx. Some strange randomly also you can take into consideration mz. So this is closed by this thing, and it's closed by this. So these brackets are very important. So this quantifier is operating till this extent. So this is till here, and then we are closing this one with this, and this is closed by this thing. That's why there are three brackets here. So now let us assume that this is the formula and all. Now we are trying to talk about the scope of the quantifier. So now what are the variables that exist here? X, y, and z. These are the individual variables that you will see in this particular kind of formula. So now these are considered to be quantifiers. So now in this formula, so this is over the whole thing. So the occurrence, now we need to talk about sub formulas. So what are the sub formulas? This is one, and this can be one more, and this whole thing can be said to be another kind of sub formula. That means fx and cy can be one sub formula, and there exists some y and all these things. This can be one sub formula of the main formula, or it can be only simply this particular kind of thing. So now with respect to the universal quantifier for all x, y and z are considered to be free, because this bracket is still this extent. So now with respect to this particular kind of quantifier, so this is considered to be bounded, because this is within the scope of this particular kind of quantifier. And even this is also in the second sub formula also, this is bounded by this particular kind of quantifier. So now what are considered to be free with respect to this universal quantifier? These are the variables that are considered to be free with respect to this thing. Even then the second sub formula also, so this z is also considered to be free with respect to this particular kind of quantifier. The first y and z are considered to be free, whereas the rest of the individual variables are considered to be bounded with respect to both the quantifiers, that is for all x or there exists some y. So now with respect to x, the first occurrence, this one, this and z are considered to be free. So now fx is bounded by for all x here, y is free here, and then with respect to this particular kind of quantifier, and y is bounded by this thing, and in with respect to this individual existential quantifier, x and z are considered to be free. So now we can list out this thing. So it is like this. So what are considered to be free here are these things. In the first occurrence, in this particular kind of formula, x is considered to be free. X is considered to be bound. In the second sub formula, this second sub formula, so this is considered to be bound and all. But in this case, y, in the first occurrence, y is free. First occurrence means first sub formula, y is considered to be free. So in this case, y is considered to be bounded. But in the second occurrence of this quantifier, for all there exists some y, x and z is also considered to be free. So in this sense, one can find out when we can say that a given quantifier binds the individual variable. So in this example, the first y and z are considered to be free. First y z means the moment you start reading the formula from the left, y and z are considered to be free. and in the second case, in the second sub formula, y is bounded whereas x and z are considered to be free, and rest of the individuals are considered to be bound. So in the same way one can talk about this particular kind of thing. We can talk about some more example, like the quantifier, for example, in this case are there are three quantifiers. There does not exist that some x, there exists some y for all z. It's a complex kind of thing, you know. There exists some w, azw implies a yz and axy. This is, let us say, this is considered to be a complex kind of formula. With this kind of thing, I will end this lecture. So now here, what are the quantifiers? There exists some x, there exists some y, and there exists some w are considered to be the quantifiers. To start with, azw is the one which you are seeing in this formula, is bounded by the quantifier there exists some w. So now the scope of that one is azw. So now with respect to for all z, entire thing is considered to be bounded, that is there exists some w, azw implies ayz, that is considered to be bounded. So with respect to the quantifier there exists some y, and whatever follows after that one in the brackets, that is for all z there exists some w, azw implies ayz and axy, that is considered to be within the scope of there exists some y. Now with respect to there exists some x, and whatever follows after that one is considered to be within the scope of that particular kind of thing. So this is the way in which the quantifier operates over a given formula. So later we will see the significance of why we are talking about, why we need to know that a given formula is bound with respect to a formula, or when why we need to know that a given formula is free. So in this class I discussed about some of the basic building blocks of predicate logic, and we started with predicates which consists of some terms, etc., and we defined what we mean by a term, and then I introduced two quantifiers, and I did not discuss about the relationship between these two quantifiers. This one quantifier can be defined with respect to another one, can be reduced to the other one. So the other thing which I discussed is, when do you say that given variable is considered to be bound, or it is considered to be free? So we need this information, especially in knowing the validity of a given formula, or a given formula is considered to be a well-formed formula, especially, or a sentence in the predicate logic, especially when it is bounded, etc. So we need to know some information about whether or not a given variable is bounded or not to have some kind of sentences in the predicate logic. We will discuss about we'll continue with the syntax in the next class, and we will also talk about the semantics of the predicate logic, what we mean by saying that for all x axy is going to be true, etc. So these are the things which we are going to discuss in the next class.